آله وأصحابه أجمعين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمنا بنور الفهم وافتح علينا بمعرفة العلم وسهل أخلاقنا بالحلم واجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه اللهم اجعل أعمالنا خالصة لوجهك ولا تجعل فيها حظا لغيرك وصل اللهم على سيدنا ونبينا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How's everyone today?
Alhamdulillah. Just give me a second.
We were just finishing of Surah Al-Mulk. In fact, we kind of did finish it, but we were still supposed to do some tafsir of those last couple of ayat. Thereafter, inshallah, we're going to move on to Suratul Kahf. Right. So, just to finish with Surah Mulk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Ba'da a'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim." ويقولون متى هذا الوعد إن كنتم صادقين قل إنما العلم عند الله وإنما أنا نذير مبين فلما رأوه زلفة سيئت وجوه الذين كفروا وقيل هذا الذي كنتم به تدعون قل أرأيتم إن أهلكني الله ومن معي أو رحمنا فمن يجير الكافرين من عذاب أليم قل هو الرحمن آمنا به وعليه توكلنا فستعلمون من هو في ضلال مبين قل أرأيتم إن أصبح ماؤكم غورا فمن يأتيكم بماء معين. صدق الله العظيم. I just read to the end of the surah, but we're supposed to talk about, was it the last verse or second and last? Just the last one. So basically in this section, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was basically, you know, wrapping up the surah that speaks about it speaks about the year after, mostly. But the focus is on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the owner, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the king, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the one with authority, the one with all knowledge. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't speak about those things in a vacuum. Allah's not telling it to you just so that you know. Allah doesn't give us all of these ayat speaking about His qudra, about His ability, speaking about His knowledge and showing us all the manifestations in this world and in the year after and informing us about. Allah doesn't just tell it to us just for the sake of knowing, right? There is a moral imperative in all of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that on account of that, on account of this knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you, you must now, number one, it's not just a moral imperative, but you must imbibe it as a system of belief, number one. You must believe in it. Number two, you must be intellectually content with it, and the one is belief in the heart. It's something beyond just being intellectually convinced of something. You must be intellectually convinced of it. And then that moral imperative must drive you to act in a certain way in this life, right? In the hope of attaining the good outcomes of those actions in the next life. But all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all intending to attain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in this end part of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just reminds us of some manifestations of Him being the owner. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Firstly, they meted a challenge out to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is, bring us this punishment. Bring us the promise if it's really true. Rasulullah just tells him, I'm just a warner, a clear warner. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes over and Allah says, when they see this punishment coming close, their faces will become sorry and it will be said to them, this is what you were this is what you were calling for. قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُ مِنْ أَهْلَكَنِيَ اللَّهُ وَمَنْ مَعْيَ أَوْ رَحِمَنَا. Allah then tells Rasulullah, oh Rasulullah, tell them that, you know, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to destroy us, or if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to show us mercy, who is it that's going to look after you? We have done, we have striven in our lives to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to attain His pleasure. So at least we have an excuse before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we tried. As for you, the disbelieving people, those people who deny His existence, who is going to stand in your stead? Who is going to protect you? فَمَنْ يُجِيرُ الْكَافِرِينَ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ قُلْ هُوَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَآمَنَّا بِهِ وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا. Say to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, هُوَ الرَّحْمَنُ, He is the most merciful, meaning he is Allah the most merciful. آمَنَّا بِهِ, أي we believe in Him. وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا, second thing, we place our trust in Him. We place our trust in Him. Why these two things? Because it connects the discourse with what came before it, right? Rasulullah was to ask them the question, who, you know, we're living our lives in a certain way, right? In a manner that we believe pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on this divine revelation. You cannot say the same for yourself because your life is not guided by scripture. You know very well, for a person that doesn't follow an external source of guidance from himself, he knows, at most he thinks that he's following his intellect. At most he thinks that he's following his intellect to what it guides him to best. But most of the time, to make a distinction between following one's intellect and following one's passion and desire, it's almost impossible. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to tell them that if this punishment eventually comes, we've lived our lives in a way that makes us deserving of being protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have lived your lives heedless of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is there to protect you. So, you know, you do your thing, we do our thing. But no, we believe in Allah and we put our trust in Allah. If this punishment comes, our trust is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect us. On account of what? On account of our belief and our striving in His path. As for you, you neither believed in Him. That's kufr here is the opposite of iman. Right? So you can see that there's a juxtaposition of positions over there. Rasulullah in the end of the one verse refers to them as kafirin. فَمَنْ يُجِيرُ الْكَافِرِينَ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. And then he starts the next verse, قُلْ هُوَ الرَّحْمَنُ آمَنَّا بِهِ. There's a contrast there between kufr and iman. So on account, it's on account of your kufr that you have nobody to protect you, and it's on account of our iman that we are able to put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ مَنْ هُوَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. So soon you will know. Rasulullah is told to tell them. They challenged him. I'll be with you now. They challenged him, bring us the punishment if it's true. Rasulullah then throws a challenge back at him. Soon you will know who is in the who is in clear estrangement.
Yeah, the word that's in that word,
yes.
In place of the word sofa.
You know, sa and sofa are different, but they both have the meaning of making a word future tense. فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ مَنْ هُوَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends of the surah completely by saying what? قُلْ سَيَّأُ مُحَمَّدْ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ. What does it mean? We did the translation, right? And أَرَأَيْتُمْ we've come across many times before. What does it mean? Have you seen? But also, what do you think, right? We said three meanings to that word. See with your mind's eye, to see with your physical eye, and to see in a dream. So Allah says, قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ. Say it to them, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. But we know also, when we have that word say before question, أَرَأَيْتُمْ, we can translate it as ask, right? Ask them, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Why am I saying, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم? Why? It's not the name, is not the... Oh, how is it implied? What kind of word is qul? It's amr. Right? And who is the amr directed at? The second person, isn't it? Right? The second person. So the second person would be the one that you are directly speaking to. Not the one speaking, but the one that's being spoken to.
So that's an indication.
Yes, that's it. So usually in the Quran, you know, we might have just been going along with this without having said it, but usually in the Quran, the direct recipient of the Quran is whom? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So most of the time when the Quran makes a singular direct address, then it's implied that it is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the Quran makes a, in the singular form, and a direct address, like it's second person, it's addressing the second person, then it implies Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one being spoken to. So it's Allah giving command to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why we say, ask them, or ask O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَرَأَيْتُمْ, what do you think? إِنْ أَصْبَحَ مَاءُكُمْ غَوْرًا. Yes, إِنْ means if. So we know when we have if, then we have a if and then a, then if this then that. So if أَصْبَحَ مَاءُكُمْ غَوْرًا. أَصْبَحَ means what?
To become,
yes. Yes, how many scales have we learned? Five. Right. Five. So which form is this one?
Four.
Four, that's correct. Yes. Asbaha yusbihun. Interesting word. What's the root letters of the word? Sa, sad, ba, ha. What do you know from me? Subah. What time of the day is subah? Morning, right. So subah, asbaha, can mean to be or become in the morning, or it can just mean to be or become. Yes. Asbaha is also one of the sisters of kana. You see kana all over the place as well, right? And kana is a number form, so when you learn about kana, inshallah, I don't want to jump the gun over there, right? When you actually have a formal lesson on kana, you will learn the certain specific rules that pertain to kana, and also the certain words that are the sisters of kana that work the same like kana. Asbaha is one of them. So, yeah. In asbaha ma'ukum, if what becomes? Ma'ukum, ma is water, ma'ukum, your water. If your water becomes ghawran, what does ghawran mean? Ghawran means sunken. Sunken. Ghara, the verb ghara, yaghuru, means to penetrate something. Right? Or to bore deeply into something. Ghara, yaghuru. So this word ghawr is the master of that word. No. I don't want to get into it now because there's something about asbaha. You have to learn the rule of asbaha, then you'll see the actual structure of that. This is, it's kind of the khabar of the sentence, kind of. But here we will say it's the khabar of asbaha. But you're going to tell me now what the khabar is supposed to be in raf. Yeah, it's in nasb. So it's a different grammatical rule over there, right? So, yes. So, in asbaha ma'ukum ghawran. If your water becomes deep sunken, what does that deep sunken mean? It's sunken into the ground. You see, how would people in a desert get their water? Dig wells. Right? This ghawran mean doesn't just mean sunken into the earth. It means like extremely deeply sunken, such that they cannot reach it by digging for it. So basically, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes them to not have access to water, that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about. فَمَنْ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِمَاءٍ مَعِينٍ. Then Allah asks, فَمَنْ, then who? So the response the response to, you know, you have in, if this, then that, then this is like the jawab. Then, man ya'tikum, man means what? Who? Who ya'tikum, ata ya'ti means to? Ata ya'ti means to come. Ata ya'ti means to come. Write that down. I'm going to ask you that in future and you're not going to get it right. Somebody's not going to get it, I can almost guarantee you. Because ata ya'ti comes often and its form on the fourth bab, ata yu'ti, also comes often. Ata means to come, ata means to give. And people always forget it. Every single year that I've been teaching, I ask a class and always they get it wrong. Ata, that's on the first bab, right? Ata ya'ti. Means to? To come. Like ja'a. And then on the fourth bab, it's supposed to be a'ta. But it just becomes a'ta. Yu'ti means to give. And what makes it more confusing is that oftentimes this form here is used with the harf ba. That's a harful jar, yes? When this root letter or this word is followed by the harf ba, b, it means to bring. Followed by the harf ba. If it's followed by the ba, then it means to bring. So can you see here? فَمَنْ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِمَا. Alright. So what's it going to mean here? If you just translate it literally, you'll get it as well. To come with something. To bring something. So فَمَنْ. Then who will? أَتَى يَأْتِي. Who will? Come. Who is the fa'il of ya'ti? What does man mean? Who? So ismul mawsool, but also in a questioning sense here. Ata, the fa'il is either at the end of it. Is it at the end of it here? Is that kum the fa'il or is that an added maf'ul? Remember, it must be like a tum or something like that. If it was at the end of it, it's not a tum. Kum is one of your dhamirs that get attached, right? So it's not at the end. Is it to the left of it? No, there's a harful jar, ismul majroor, the bima. Okay, is it inside? Yes. Inside ata ya'ti, which is the standard form, there's a huwa, referring to the man. So who will bring? Who will come? Kum. So what does that kum mean? Whom is they? Kum is? You. Right. Who will come to you? Or who will bring you? I may tell me, but there's no two here. Right. It doesn't have to be there. That's just how the word works in Arabic. Excuse me? Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Who will bring you? But now because we translated the word as be, sorry, because we translated the word as bring, we know that that be is not going to have a translation. Who will bring you be ma in just water? If I didn't translate it as bring and I translated it as come, who will come to you, then you can translate it as with water. Ma'inin means what? Flowing water. Yes, flowing water. The root letters come from the word Ayn. Ayn is a spring. Oh, the word Ayn has tons of meaning. The word Ayn can mean a thing, the word Ayn can mean an eye, the word Ayn can mean a spring, the word Ayn can mean a corporeal as opposed to a user fract. The word Ayn just has tons of meanings. So, the most common ones that you're going to come across is eye and spring. Those are the most common ones you're going to come across. So, let me just go over that verse again. قُلْ Say, O Muhammad, that word ma'in over thee is a sifa for the word ma. Right. So, let's look at it again. قُلْ Say, O Muhammad, أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِنْ أَصْبَحَ مَاؤُكُمْ غَوْرًا فَمَنْ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِمَاءٍ مَعِينٍ. After speaking about, you know, the punishment of the year after and averting the punishment of the year after and believing in Allah, putting your trust in Allah, Allah ends of the surah by asking a simple question. O Muhammad, just ask them this question. If Allah makes your water inaccessible to you, who's going to bring you water? Yes? Yes. Yes, precisely. In relation to the rest of the surah, all about the unseen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just refers you to one question. There's something as simple as water. You can't live without it. You can't live without it. You can have whatever abilities you want. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala withholds the water from you, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do? That's not even speaking about something of the unseen, not speaking about... It's just speaking about the simple worldly phenomena. But what does that phenomena do? It shows you your dependence on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, willingly or unwillingly. Whether you depend on Allah and you acknowledge that you depend on Allah for water, it doesn't matter. Because even if you don't acknowledge that you depend on Allah, if Allah withholds the water, there's nothing you can do about it. There's nothing you can do about it. So that's why it's a powerful metaphor at the end of the surah. To do what? To give you a question that tells you or that shows to you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the king. You can't do anything without his authority. And whether you want to depend on him or you don't want to depend on him, the reality is you have to depend on him. Right, so this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends of the surah, Suratul Mulk, by asking a simple question. The question relates to water. That question is, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes you to have a lack of access to water, then who's going to give you access to water? Such a fundamental need of yours. Such a fundamental need of yours. And such a simple thing that we take for granted. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't give you access to it, then what are you going to do about that? There's something profound here as well. Usually when we think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowing us access to water, then we think of rain coming down, isn't it? But yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't refer to it as rain coming down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it as even if the rain comes down and then sinks into the ground, you still won't have access to it. So even if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lets the water come to the earth, you should think that you have all ability to now capture this water, etc. But especially to a desert people, this, and you know, they were the first recipients of the Quran, the people of Mecca. This metaphor will appeal to them greatly because they didn't have huge dams that they built in the well, etc. In the desert, etc. So they required that ability to actually bore holes into the ground and access the water. But so that's a point of rhetoric that may relate specifically to the people of that time, but the access to water, the general question of the thing applies to people of all time. But again, it's all there to remind us of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's authority over everything. Just to remind ourselves that we've reached the end of Suratul Mulk. Suratul Mulk is a surah with a number of virtues. Right? It has a number of names. I told you this at the beginning, just as a reminder, because we started the surah so long ago. The surah has a number of names, right? Suratul Mulk, Tabarak, Al-Mani'a. Tabarak, you know, right? The one that's full of blessings and exalted. Mulk, you know, the kingdom. But it has other names as well. Al-Mani'a, the defender. Al-Waqiyah, the shield. Not Waqi'ah. That's other surah in the Quran. Al-Waqiyah, wa the ya, the shield. Al-Munjiyah, the savior. Right? There's another name for it that comes elsewhere. Al-Muqashqisha. It's also like the defender. There's all different names for the surah. Tabarak. Why? Why the savior? Why the shield? Why the defender? Because the one that recites it often, its companion will be saved from the punishment of the grave. And if you are saved from the punishment of the grave, and as Uthman radiallahu anhu said, that if you are saved from the punishment of the grave, then every stage beyond that is going to be better. Right? And if one is not saved from the punishment of the grave, then every stage beyond that will be worse. So there's hadith that's mentioned in relation to this that say that قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ تَعْدِلُ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ, the surah قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ is equivalent to a third of the Qur'an. Not in terms of, okay, I don't feel like reading the Qur'an, I'm just recite قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ three times. No. In terms of, perhaps in terms of reward that you get, but also in terms of the fact that it speaks about Tawheed, and that comprises of, or belief specifically, and that essentially comprises at least of a third of the content of the Qur'an. But the hadith continues and it says, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِي الْمُلْكِ تُجَادِلُ عَنْ صَاحِبِهَا. The companion of Suratul Mulk, the companion of Suratul Mulk will have Suratul Mulk, the surah, argue on its behalf. Meaning like it will be your lawyer at the time of questioning. And it will argue on your behalf. So what is it? It's obviously speaking about the metaphysical reality. You know, in the year after, these abstract things will be given forms. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in other surah of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about deeds having weights. You know, their deeds will not have any weight. But a deed is an abstract thing, it doesn't have weight. So some of the Mufassirun, I know Mufti Muhammad Shafi Uthman is one of them, in his Ma'arif al-Quran, that's translated in English, he speaks, if I'm not mistaken, in which surah is it now? He's speaking about where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to deeds being weighed on the day of Qiyamah and certain deeds having no weight. I think it's in Surah Al-Kahf, at the end of Surah Al-Kahf. Anyways, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Inshallah, we'll come back. But anyways, he speaks there about in the year after, these abstract concepts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them physical forms and they will have weights. So, for example, there's a hadith in which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, kalimatani khafifatani ala lisan. There are two words that are light on the tongue. Habibatani or thaqilatani fil mizan. They are heavy on the scale. The word doesn't originally have any weight attached to it. The word itself. You may say, okay, the breath that comes out of my mouth, whatever, but even that, it's like minuscule. It doesn't conform with what the hadith is saying. The hadith is saying these two statements will be heavy on the scale. Habibatani ila ar-Rahman, they are beloved to the most merciful. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. And then Rasul teaches us those two words of adhkar. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, glory be to Allah, all praise due to Him. Subhanallah al-azim, glory be to Allah, the exalted. The hadith is beautiful in and of itself. Yes, make the dhikr in abundance, they'll be loved to Allah, they'll be heavy on your scales and they'll light on your tongue. But the reason I'm quoting the hadith is the fact that these words will have weight. So Similarly, certain actions and certain abstract things will be given forms. Will be given forms in the next life. For example, the Quran will come in the form of a beautiful man and will stand beside the person in his grave when he's being questioned. So there's that reality. It's matters of the afterlife, and it's not bound by the laws of physics of this world, etc. It's metaphysical realities that we believe in. So why I'm telling you this is because we must make the recitation of Suratul Mulk a habit of ours. And everybody has room to improve. I myself have room to improve in this regard. As we have actions that we do every day, we should try and, you know, when we wake up, we make some adiyah. When we go sleep, we make some adiyah. When we, you know, throughout the day, we make some adhkar, etc. We should make the recitation of Suratul Mulk a daily habit of ours as well. Right? Why? So that we can be considered the companion of Suratul Mulk. And when we are considered the companion of Suratul Mulk, then you must know that Suratul Mulk will come and argue on your behalf on the day when you can't pay a lawyer to come work for you, no matter how much money you have. Right, so may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, make us cling to Suratul Mulk. We move on, inshallah, to Suratul Kahf. Suratul Kahf is another beautiful surah. Tell me quickly, what page is it in? It's on page number 19 in your books. In the second book. Okay, can I start? I'm going to just, today we're not going to get, mostly we're not going to get into the surah, but I'm going to give you some introductory, do we have time? Okay, 5 minutes. So we're just going to mention some introductory things about the surah. Firstly, as you know, the name of the surah is Suratul Kahf. What's the Kahf? A Kahf is a cave. Right. And where does it get this name Al-Kahf from? The first story in the surah is about Ashabul Kahf, the companions of the cave, and they were a group of youth we will speak about as we get into the surah. There's a number of words for cave. Yeah, there are connotations, inshallah. We'll get into that, inshallah, a bit later. And so the name of the surah is Al Kahf, the cave. Now there's something really nice about the relationship between the name and the content of the surah. But before we get into the content of the surah also has some virtues, a number of virtues to the recitation of Suratul Kahf. One of those virtues is that the person that recites Suratul Kahf or that memorizes certain verses of Suratul Kahf, they will be protected from Dajjal, from the fitna of Al-Dajjal. And though we don't live our lives, every moment of our lives, fearing, oh, the Dajjal is coming out, no. But even from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about it as a reality that's close at hand and that we should prepare for. Not by being fixated on it, but by just taking the necessary, simple, consistent steps in our daily lives. So, what are some of the hadith that mention virtues of the surah? One is narrated in Sahih Muslim by Abu Darda radiallahu anhu that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever memorizes 10 verses from the beginning of Suratul Kahf, usima min ad-dajjal, he will be protected from ad-dajjal. And there's a number of There is a long discussion on that, because there's a number of ayat that mention a similar thing. There's some that say 10 at the beginning, 10 at the end. There's some that say 5 at the beginning, 5 at the end. There's some that say 3 at the beginning, 3 at the end. So everyone has its virtue, but obviously the more, the merrier. So, you know, if one finds difficulty in memorization, and I believe, you know, everybody has the ability to memorize just with different amounts of effort. But if nothing else, at least try and remember, memorize 3 verses from the beginning, 3 from the end, at least. Because then perhaps you will get the virtue of that, of those ahadith. Right, so there's narrations that speak about all of that. But the general virtue of it is that you'll be protected from the Dajjal on account of having memorized those verses. Then there's another virtue of it. An Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu. He says, Man qara'a surat al-Kahfi, and this narration is mentioned by Al-Bayhaqi rahimahullah ta'ala. He says, whoever recites Surah Al-Kahf yawm al-Jum'ah, on the day of Jum'ah, on a Friday, starting from Thursday evening, Thursday night after Maghrib, till Friday before Maghrib, from Maghrib till, from after the one Maghrib sets in until before the next Maghrib, whoever recites Surah Al-Kahf on the Friday, أضاء له أشهر هذا يوم الجمعة أضاء له من النور ما بين الجمعتين. He will be illuminated with a special nur between the two Jumas. He will be illuminated by a special light from one Jumah to the next. So the idea is recite Surah Al-Kahf at least every Friday, and then inshallah that will serve as an illumination for us. And who doesn't want to be illuminated? And illumination is what? It's not just, okay, there's a light, okay, but I don't see people walking around looking very bright or anything. No, it's a spiritual light. It's indicative of having a special ri'ayah and favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you. And there's a reason for this. You may think, why does this surah have this virtue? As we unravel the surah, you'll see the beauty of it, inshallah, and the reminder that it provides for us. And there's another hadith in which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, in a longer hadith, he mentions as part of it, in yakhruj, speaking about Dajjal, he says, in yakhruj wa ana fikum fa ana hajijuhu dunakum. If Dajjal comes whilst I'm with you, then I will oppose him, you know, in lieu of you. You want to have the burden of that, I will oppose him. Wa in yakhruj wa lastu fikum, but if I am not with you when Dajjal comes, فَمْرُؤٌ حَجِيجُ نَفْسِهِ, then every man must fight for himself. But what is he saying? وَاللَّهُ خَلِيفَتِي عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ, but I entrust every Muslim in the hands of, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, every man has to argue on behalf of himself, but I entrust you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمَنْ أَدْرَكَهُ مِنْكُمْ, so whoever, you know, reaches that time, فَلْيَقْرَأْ عَلَيْهِ فَوَاتِحَ سُورَةِ الْكَهْفِ. What must he do? He must recite the beginning portions of Surah Al-Kahf. فَإِنَّهَا جِوَارُكُمْ مِنْ فِتْنَتِهِ, because that will protect you from the fitna of Al-Dajjal. Our time is up. We will continue, inshallah, with the introduction to Surah Al-Kahf next week. And then we will get into the surah thereafter. But we end there for now. وَجَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرُ وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانِ الْحَمْدِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. السَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.